In the name of the one who was and is to come. Amen. Raise your hand if you bought an Advent calendar this year. Anybody? All right. Excellent. A friend gave me one this week. It was an online version. Turns out that making virtual snowflakes is even better than the version we did with paper and scissors growing up. I don't know if you guys like to do that, but I sure did. And online, there are endless patterns and possibilities without any of the cleanup. Well, Advent calendars are around a lot right now, and I rather love them, even though they might seem trite, I guess, if you see them everywhere, right? But they have this kind of reassuring promise. If you don't like what is behind the daily window, hang in there. You can get to tomorrow. Well, today, after this service, we're going to have children's chapel over in this space, and I am going to invite you to explore with me, if you have the time. It's only like 15 minutes, so I need you to do it. What this Advent calendar, some of you might recognize it, you might even have it at home, has to do with this purple banner over here, a banner about the Jesse tree. Yes, the ancient Jesse tree, with its strange stories that hearken from the Hebrew Bible, are tied to that scripture we heard from the prophet Isaiah that Bev read for us this morning, a scripture passage from our Old Testament that talks about God's mysterious purposes in that unlikely and sometimes unseemly history of the people called Israel, the people from whom Jesus descends, in that family of David that Jesse gives rise to. And it's sometimes funny, these pictures we have, a shoot and a stump. If you're not hanging around a lot of trees, you might not know what on earth to make of that. But this ancient Advent way of daring us to look through the windows of Scripture and to find surprising signs of love breaking into our world, it long predates those strategic moves of calendar purveyors like Trader Joe's, Costco, or even Jackie Lawson. Love it or leave it, this seasonal tradition encourages us to search for treasure. And those directed ways of peeking, don't get ahead of yourself, but peeking into each daily window, trains our hearts. Our hearts are wired to anticipate. It trains our hearts to be curious about the ways God wants to transform our lives. And that transformation always is beyond our wildest expectations. Well, turns out adults like this fun too. And some of them came up with something called Advent Word, which is an offshoot of this Jesse Tree Advent calendar custom. Advent Word has these daily invitations to prayer. It's a curated calendar of reflections from folks all around the world, and it is a practice in this time that helps me wait with hope in Advent. These are meditations that the Episcopal Church began to curate in an offshoot from a daily word practice started by some of my favorite monks on the planet, and they happen to live in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and they're part of an order called the Society St. John the Evangelist. Yes, these monks are a community of spiritual leaders, prophetic voices, who have been looking to help us and Christians all around the world understand how God moves in our lives. Well, when Forward Movement took up the Advent Word Project in 2019, they began to build on this foundation of monastic wisdom, and they started to invite these reflections from all around the world. If you explore the offering, and you sure can online, you'll probably notice some patterns that start to emerge year over year. There's 24 words chosen every Advent, and there are some commonalities year by year. My brain happens to like noticing patterns like that. So if you, like I, find yourself curious, you can visit the website. Yes, I like those kinds of patterns, just like my taste buds like dark chocolate. So this week, I started hunting for some patterns in those words. For whatever reason, I wanted to find out which ones started with the letter H. Well, in 2019, brothers began their Brother Give Us a Word series, and in those, I found another gem, hope. We heard that also in our scriptures today. I kind of admit, though, I was sort of hoping I was going to find HE double hockey sticks somewhere in that digital hunt. Because, not so different from those tiny little calendar windows, this morning's gospel from Matthew pops open with a splash, introducing us to a prophet who's famous for dishing out a little bit of hellfire through his ministry here in the desert. Maybe you have to channel a bit of the burning bush to get noticed out there in the wilderness. And John the Baptist, he sure delivers. His fashion sense is a bit wild. I don't know, leather belts are pretty okay, but camel's hair? It's a little scratchy. His dietary preferences, even weirder. Do any of you have chocolate-covered locusts in your calendars? Well, John splashes onto that Jordan River scene, asking people to take a plunge. And the Jordan was not a nice, clean swimming pool. It was a very muddy river. His point was not about jumping in and having a good time. It was actually grappling with those things in our lives that aren't quite the way we would like it. Those murky places where we might feel that tension between what we want and hope to be as people of love and the ways that our behavior sometimes falls short of that. Jarring as John's altar call sounds to our modern ears this morning. He's talking about Jesus coming with a winnowing fork and separating the grain from the chaff. It sounds a little bit like that sheep and the goats gospel that Matthew also tells. Well, it might not be as scary as it seems, though I think it pushes us to dig a little bit deeper. Yes, John's words crackle with his own unique brand of the macabre. There is humor that the Hebrew prophets leverage in the ways they communicate with the people, and sometimes that gets lost in translation for us as we listen in on those conversations. Honey, Holy Spirit, and hand of God, those all seem pretty understandable. Those words aren't such a stretch. Matthew knows we're with him there. But by the time we get to those images, John's edginess is captivating and also kind of repulsive. Are we the chaff? Are we the wheat? Are we going to get burned up? Well, I was reminded of how dark comedy can work when I caught sight of a preview. I didn't get to go see this film yet, but maybe some of you have. And I think John is giving Ralph Fiennes in that recent box office hit, the prickly sort of party host, daring unsuspecting guests to wake up and smell what's cooking for dinner, and maybe even find ourselves somewhere on the menu. Yes, if like me, you haven't yet watched The Menu, it is a dark comedy. And I think John's peculiar style is trending in that direction. Maybe dark comedy isn't your spiritual cup of tea. The first time I saw Fargo, I walked right out of that Coen Brothers film. I couldn't get it. I didn't want to get it. Talking about people and woodchoppers? Ugh. But these prophets, they're doing something. They're trying to get under our spiritual skin, to get our attention. Yes, their imagery is anything but subtle. It's provocative and subversive, wielding this strange energy that reminds us this connection we share with God. It's not something we get to dictate. We can't control it. And there is a strange kind of relief in that bizarre truth-telling. I'm not just talking about the prophets in the Bible, but they had a way of bringing in fire because fire was part of what people knew to expect with God. Look at all the Old Testament stories, including some of those from the Jesse tree, and you'll see people's relationship was through the temple practices. There were offerings of grain. They would take the grain and offer it on the altar, and it would get burned up. And that was part of how they knew God was there with them. There were animals that they brought up and offered to God that were also put on the altar and offered as a sacrifice. There were lots of ways that way different than what we do today. But there was something about the prophets that was putting a little bit of extra energy to the things that people found familiar to make a point. Now I get that picturing Jesus with a winnowing fork in his hand, tossing things into unquenchable fire, it's not a joke. But there is some irony in John's words that are meant to dig deeper through humor. Prophetic voices in our day similarly needle us, often in the ways we need most. After all, caricature and satire and other tools of humor are these merciful ways of lowering our defenses, helping us laugh at ourselves and hear difficult truths that we sometimes don't have the ability to say out loud for ourselves. Humor also puts us back in touch with the wisdom we carry in our bodies. It's a lot more bearable to come into contact with those tensions that we walk around with, that we maybe ignore, than to actually have to come at them directly. Think of the comedians that you admire the most. How do they bring relief in the ways that they wield humor? One of my friends has been helping me understand the provocative power of humor. He's been using it in his work with leaders and educators around the world as they think about the most effective ways to bring positive change in a polarized world. In his work, that's especially been present around issues of race in our country. His experiences have helped me see a little bit more about this opportunity we have to sharpen our awareness, our appreciation of the humor that's right there in our Bible, though it is a couple of degrees removed from us because it is from another time and in another place. And this humor in the Bible helps us dig deeper for that treasure that is hidden there among the punchlines. When we just listen plainly to these texts, we can want to tune out these provocateurs, but you gotta hand it to them. They know their craft. And John's way of baiting his audience is an art form that frees people to move toward healing and wholeness, maybe even the kind they didn't even know they were craving. John demands people own up to their deeper motivations. He dares us to embrace the transformation that we also want. We can't simply go through the motions, wading into the river, coming out on the other end without amending your ways. Faith is not just a clever game. Yes, we cannot play God controlling access to what lies hidden behind those sacred doors. We also, like John reminds the people coming to the river to see what he's up to, none of us get to bank on inherited spiritual assets. Even we who've been engrafted into that stump of Jesse, we, Jesus's offshoots, we're not exempt from bearing righteous fruit. I wonder what John is goading us to wake up to. I wonder how we need to live differently. Advent is a time to heed prophetic voices, a time to embrace the healing they invite us to welcome. For God always brings what is hidden to light with a blazing love that purifies us so that we can encounter God. That axe that John insists is lying at the foot of the tree is an image that challenges all of us to look for those painful, sometimes provocative truths. It calls us to submit to Jesus' pruning in our lives, because most of the time we're not any good about getting rid of the dead stuff, are we? No, Jesus alone can raise what has been dead, and the Lord of all comes to give us his true life. While we may not yet be counting down the days, Jesus indeed is coming soon. Let us be among those who wait with hope. Amen.